Okay. All right, everybody. I think we'll get started. We do have some folks coming down from upstairs, but we're pretty sure they're going to be with us very shortly. So thank you for being on time after lunch. We really appreciate it because we've got to got a few hard stops later this afternoon we just have to be aware of. But for those who can stay for the duration, we will be addressing all questions and answers in a comprehensive session that Kristen and I will do at the end of everything. So it's really my pleasure. We're going to sort of change gears a little bit, but the emphasis on the talks, just to sort of stress, is that from feedback from previous years, we've learned that sometimes it's important to sort of take a fresh look at the same concept, but with a different prism. In other words, a certain amount of emphasis on the same themes. And so to some extent, you'll hear some of that during the course of the talks, but we'll each be bringing out different aspects, because that's the feedback we've gotten from previous courses, that if you hear it only once, it's very difficult to absorb in the context of the whole day. So having a recurrent theme of new drugs, new developments, where they're going, and how they then matter in various different perspectives is how we've sought to structure the day. So with that in mind, it's really my privilege to introduce Kathy. Kathy and I, believe it or not, have worked together since 1994, and she still puts up with me, which I have never quite understood. But anyway, and that being said, Kathy is one of our senior and lead clinical research nurse, working in partnership with a fabulous research nurse team, and Kristen is another superb example. But the point is that our research nursing in the myeloma group, we've always considered our jewel, actually. It's really the strength of our program, in my view. And it really has borne great fruit for our patients, most importantly, but also for our research and the quality of it. And I think internationally, our research nursing team is fully recognized. So in that vein, Kathy's going to talk to us about symptom management, which she's been on the forefront of with her colleague, Debbie Doss, who many of you know. And basically, in that context, she's going to talk about symptom management of a variety of different challenges that we face with new therapies. And she does a beautiful talk. It's really my privilege to ask Kathy to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Richardson, and welcome, everybody. Good afternoon. I'm very, very excited to be here. You know, I've been now going into my 17th year just working with multiple myeloma, and I've been an oncology nurse for well over 20 years. And, you know, as a clinical research nurse, I'm just so grateful to have been a part of the research that is ongoing in multiple myeloma. I was there at the beginning with all the physicians when we started looking at novel therapies back in the year 2000. So, you know, for my part and being a research nurse, this has just been just so exciting. But of course, the excitement in the treatments for multiple myeloma translate into into hope and for new treatment therapies for our patients with myeloma. So I thought I'd just kind of go over the basics and just talk a little about multiple myeloma. So if you want to look at this slide here. So I'm sure from earlier talks today you heard Dr. Anderson, Dr. Munchie, Dumpa Raji, you know, talking about all of the new developments that we have in multiple myeloma and coming back from ASH and all the excitement for newer therapies that we're going to be studying in clinical research. Last year, in November of 2015, we had three drugs approved for treatment for multiple myeloma. We had daratumumab, elotuzumab, and we had Ninlaro. And so we found this year, a couple of weeks ago, with daratumumab, that was also approved in combination with Revlimid and dexamethasone. Daratumumab is now in combination with Velcade. And so this, again, all translates to more therapies for our patients. So now we're on track here. So anyway, what is multiple myeloma? Multiple myeloma is a cancer of the plasma cells. And if we look here, I think the red here, this is what the multiple myeloma cell looks like. It has a very large nucleus that is off-center in the cell. And it's some genetic damage happens and causes the multiple myeloma cell. So it's a cancer of the plasma cells within the bone marrow. And what happens there is the genetic damage, and there's an overproliferation within the marrow of these abnormal plasma cells. And this abnormal production releases abnormal protein in the blood and in the urine. It disrupts normal bone function and also destroys and invades surrounding bones. And also, it reduces the normal immune function. the epidemiology of multiple myeloma. It's the second most common hematological malignancy in the United States. Its median age at diagnosis is about 69 years of age. Median age at death is about 75 years of age, but we know overall survival in multiple myeloma has increased exponentially since we've had all these new therapies. We see about 26,000 new cases diagnosed each year with multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is more prevalent in men than in women. We see a higher increase in African Americans than in white Americans. What is the cause of multiple myeloma? We're not sure the exact cause, and there are ongoing studies trying to look at the cause of multiple myeloma. It could be linked to radiation, overexposure to radiation, environmental toxins, exposure to pesticides, petroleum products. It could or could not be a genetic element. Have we seen this in families? Yes, but it's more rare than not. People that were exposed to Agent Orange during the Vietnam War. So again, research is ongoing looking at the etiology and the cause. These are some of the factors that may be associated with it. So the clinical presentation and common symptoms for multiple myeloma, the two main symptoms are pain from bone disease and also anemia and fatigue. So generally, the pain or the fatigue is generally what brings a patient to see their physician to get something worked up. They may have a back pain and it's been bothering them for a while, and they may see the doctor and they could do a radiograph and they could see that they may have some what we call lytic lesions or a compression fracture. Also, fatigue. Patients, can go in to tell the doctor they've not been feeling well. They can draw blood and see that they are anemic. But generally, it's interesting that often there are no symptoms in the early stages of the disease. Generally, we're not running to the doctor every time our back hurts or every time we're feeling fatigued. We all live very busy lives and, running around and working full-time and taking care of children and running shopping and all that. So nobody's always running to the doctor. And oftentimes, myeloma can also be incidentally found when somebody's going for their yearly physical. Other symptoms we can see is recurrent infections, renal dysfunction, hypercalcemia. We can see a soft mass tumor, which we call a plasmacytoma, or bone marrow involvement. So multiple myeloma, as you can see by looking at this slide, causes a myriad of complications for the patients. So when we see the abnormal proteins or within the marrow can cause an M protein, which we can see either in our urine or in our serum. So the light chains, the kappa or lambda, can cause a renal compromise. About 30% of patients, and anywhere from 2 to 13% of those patients can end up in renal failure because these light chains can clog the kidneys, again, causing renal insufficiency. Also, these abnormal proteins can cause neuropathies in patients. So it's interesting that many patients, if they have a high level of abnormal proteins, these proteins can be found on the ends of nerve fibers and causing patients to have some neuropathies. The immune deficiency here, infection, infectious complications are the major cause of morbidity and mortality in patients with multiple myeloma. So we can see that presenting at about 15% of patients, and I'll talk about that in more detail. Other complications can be marrow infiltration. The most common hematological complication we can see is anemia. So it's about 70% of patients with myeloma will present and will have anemia. From the disease and from their treatment. Also, a huge clinical complication we see is destruction of bone. And the destruction of bone can cause a hypercalcemia because when we have the lytic lesions breaking down bones, it releases large amounts of calcium into the bloodstream. Breakdown of bone can lead to bone pain, and about 70% of patients can have lytic lesions. So when we look at bone disease and the pain that it can cause patients, as these myeloma cells grow unchecked, bone destruction occurs, producing lesions, fractures, and pain for our patients. The pain particularly is associated, in the back, and especially in patients with movement. So we do see this happening, as I said, in many of the patients. And this is due to an increase of osteoclast activation process, so bone destruction. And what happens is that in multiple myeloma, the abnormal plasma cells interrupt the normal bone remodeling process. So normal bone remodeling, which happens every day, to our bones, we have what builds up our bones, which are our osteoblasts, and what breaks down our bones and cleans up areas are our osteoclasts. And what happens in multiple myeloma is that those abnormal plasma cells actually inhibit the osteoblasts from doing their job, and so now the osteoclasts are going around unchecked, and they're eating and breaking down the bone. So this is why in myeloma we do see so much bone destruction. Patients can have multiple osteolytic lesions. So what do we do about that? We obviously, we treat the disease. We have patients on therapy. We have them on their myeloma therapy, but also on bisphosphonate therapies, such as Zometa or the pimigenate that we use for our patients. We can help patients get out of pain by spot welding, what we call it, with radiation. We can offer pain medication or procedures if they have vertebral compression fractures, kyphoplasty or vertebroplasty. So the bone lesions that we see in multiple myeloma, so the bone destruction in myeloma can involve any bone, but the most common is the long and flat bones, where bone marrow production is the greatest. Bones most likely to be involved include, as we can see, the spine, the skull, the pelvis, the humerus. And so when we do see the breakdown within the spinal column, the vertebral body can actually start to fracture into impinge on the spinal cord and cause, spinal cord compression, which is a medical emergency. So this is a picture here of the pathology of what these lytic lesions are. I can stand here all day and say lytic lesions, but it's hard for us to envision what these look like. So when we look at this picture here, this is of the skull, we can see these punched out lytic lesions. And this patient, by looking at this radiograph, we can see this patient had disease for a very long period of time, and this is what these punched out lytic lesions, the osteoclast breaking down the bone. The middle picture here, this is a pathological fracture of the humerus, and so again, the weakened bone from bone disease. And also we can look around here too and see that it has very large lytic lesions, and we can see osteopenia. So when we look at the last picture here, we can see the spinal column, and we can see that the osteoclasts have eaten here at the cortical bone, and this is what causes the weakness in the vertebral body, in where we see the patients having to have, the breakdown of the bone creates patients to have vertebral compression fractures, again, causing patients to have a great deal of pain, and also they're losing height, too, with these multiple compression fractures. So how do we treat the patients and treat for the bones? Obviously, we give the bisphosphonate therapies. Bisphosphonate therapies inhibit bone destruction. So when your physician is part of your treatment, is supportive care, your physician is going to give you therapy to obviously stop the myeloma cells from growing, but we also want to strengthen the bones as we go along. So we have the bisphosphonate therapies that coat the surface of the bone, so we're trying to inhibit bone resorption. So all patients in our practices are on bone strengthening medications. We can either offer pimigenate, which we call Iridia, or the Zometa, the zoledronic acid. And I can tell you we are currently involved in studies looking at an antibody therapy for, inhibiting bone destruction, which is denosumab. So we have those studies ongoing now, and the results at this point are very exciting to be positive using an antibody therapy for us using that in treating bone disease. So patients also, like everything that we give patients, oftentimes there's always going to be some kind of a side effect. And so it's important for when our patients are on these bisphosphonate therapies that we monitor them for renal dysfunction. So again, these can cause some injury to the kidneys. So this is why we're always looking at your creatinine level. If it's elevated, we may hold therapy and give you some hydration, or we can make a dose modification. Also, we have to watch out for is osteonecrosis of the jaw. And osteonecrosis of the jaw has been linked to the bisphosphonate therapies. So this is a picture of what this looks like. And this is why this is very important, before I forget, is that we always want to make sure that all the patients are, have good dental health care, and that they're always seeing the dentist, and they should be seeing their dentist, every 6 months. And so this is something, even though it's an uncommon, complication causing avascular necrosis, necrosis, whether it's in the maxilla or the mandible. This is something that we know that can happen. And so this is why we do educate our patients all the time that if they're going to have any invasive dental work done, such as a root canal or a dental extraction, then they need to notify their clinical team first, because we need to tell, we need to stop the, you know, bisphosphonate therapy right away. And we try to, you know, have the time between stopping and having that dental procedure as far as, you know, as possible as we can, because we do see osteonecrosis of the jaw at the Brigham Women's Hospital. We do send our patients there over to the Brigham Women's Hospital Dental Clinic. They have a, you know, very very important and significant interest in looking at osteonecrosis of the jaw and treating it. So just to keep that in mind, you know, good health maintenance and dental care, and making sure that you do tell your clinic team if you're going to have any invasive dental work performed. So the current management for bone disease is, obviously, we treat the myeloma. We have many of the novel therapies that Dr. Richardson will talk about and the other physicians spoke about earlier today. We have the bisphosphonate therapies that I talked about. Also for our bones, too, is very important is calcium and vitamin D to get those levels checked. I talked about the radiotherapy that, you know, for impending fractures, cord compression. We can spot weld some areas to get patients out of pain. The vertebroplasty or kyphoplasty, and obviously we can send patients to, for an orthopedic consult, obviously, as we would do in our practice. And again, just to emphasize, is that routine dental visits to watch for an osteonecrosis of the jaw, because it could have some serious complications. So for patients that have vertebral compression fractures, we can offer vertebral plasty or balloon kyphoplasty. Both of these procedures can stabilize the fracture and correct spinal deformity caused by any of these fractures. And what with vertebral plasty is under high pressure, what they do is take a large bore needle and under pressure put in a synthetic type of a cement, which will stabilize the compression fracture. What kyphoplasty does is takes vertebroplasty an extra step. So when we look at the vertebral compression fracture here, what happens is, again, a large bore and needle is placed into the fracture, and an orthopedic balloon is inflated. So what happens here, it makes an opening or a cavity for the cement to go in, but actually can, and it's sometimes, in some points, can actually correct that deformity and actually raise that vertebrae up. And so what happens is that the orthopedic balloon is then deflated, it has left a cavity, and then the synthetic cement is placed into the vertebral body there, and hopefully, you know, getting patients out of pain, you know, almost instantaneously. Patients can have many of these kyphoplasty procedures to give stabilization to their spine, and most certainly is getting them out of pain, which is the goal. So patients with light chain disease, about 30% of patients can have light chain disease. The light chain is comprised of what we call is the kappa and lambda light chains. These are, what happens here is these light chains become abnormal, and they're called kappa and light chains. And these light chains are very, very, very small. And they can't, for the longest time, they could not be seen in the blood, so we always had patients do the 24-hour urines. And so for patients who are on especially clinical trials now, it's the dreaded, you know, collecting that 24-hour urine. But this is what we were looking for, is to look for these light chains that actually precipitate in the urine. So this is called the Benz-Jones proteinuria. And believe it or not, this test was discovered back in the late 1850s by a scientist named Dr. Benz-Jones, and we still use that test today looking for the Benz-Jones proteinuria. So it's the proteinuria test is named after Dr. Benz-Jones, which I always wanted to know why he wanted to name urine after himself, but I guess it's not a problem. So anyway, so it's called Benz-Jones proteinuria, and that's where we make you or have to have you do that 24-hour urine. Also, what we now have is the serum assay test that can look at those light chains, you know, in the serum. And so those light chains, again, can cause damage to the kidneys. And this is why, as your clinical team, we're always telling our patients they need to hydrate all the time. They need to be flushing those proteins out of their kidneys. So the renal dysfunction, which I just talked about, although not all patients with myeloma develop their nephropathies, it is a significant concern. And I mean, obviously these light chains are the greatest contributor to renal dysfunction with these monoclonal light chains. So again, supportive care is key with this. And hydration. I know patients are sick of us saying this. And then if we do see in our practice of a patient's, their creatinine level is increasing, we will give them IV hydration. Again, all part of supportive care in the whole picture of treating your multiple myeloma. Also, very, very important is to avoid the NSAIDs, so to avoid the ibuprofens that you're taking. So those also can further cause insult to your kidneys. The ibuprofens, or these NSAIDs, are vasoconstrictors, so it decreases blood flow in the kidneys, again, causing further insult to the kidneys. So this is why we educate the patients not to be taking any of the ibuprofen. Also very important is to avoid IV contrast dye when you're having a CAT scan. So even doesn't matter what institution you are at or what hospital, don't go under the assumption that they know that you have multiple myeloma, that you should not have IV contrast dye. IV contrast dye could put your kidneys into failure. So it's just very important to be educated. And if your doctor prescribes and wants you to have a CT scan, just remember, no IV contrast dye, because again, it could be very damaging to your kidneys. Oral contrast dye is okay, but again, just to keep that in mind. So if something happened, and if you were traveling and you were out of state, this is just a very important tidbit just to remember. Renal complications, I just already discussed this. I just want to just really show the picture of the kidney there. So I like pictures. It keeps your attention. So anyway, recurrent infections. So patients with myeloma have greatly increased risk for infection, as high as a 15-fold increase. Immune dysfunction is an integral part of the disease process, and the cytotoxic and the drugs that we give patients can further drive the patient's immune system response. And so because infection is the greatest and most dangerous complication for our patients with myeloma, aggressive antibiotic treatment and prophylactic therapy is very important. And I can tell you in our practice at Dana-Farber, under the guidance of Dr. Richardson, we have a very low threshold for putting patients on antibiotics. You have to remember that the normal role of the plasma cell is lost. And so if you have myeloma, you cannot fight an infection as well as you think that you can. So a simple cold to a patient with myeloma can end up into upper respiratory infection, can turn into pneumonia, and could cause death. So we have to always keep that in mind. I always am telling my patients and educating them, if they have a cold, they just need to call me, because we need to triage that if they're unable to come into clinic. So just to keep that in mind. And also, so we're giving patients antibiotics when they're needed, but also if we feel that a patient is having one infection after another, again, the normal role of the immunoglobulins is lost, the patient can't fight for the infections, oftentimes we'll put patients on gamma globulin medication. This helps to boost the patient's immune system. So it's very important just to keep that in mind and keep your clinical team informed of any type of infection that you may be having. Also, we want to make sure that our patients have the pneumonia and the influenza vaccines. We prophylax for PCP, and also if patients are on therapies, again, because they are immune compromised, opportunist infections can happen, such as herpes zoster or fungal infections. And especially on some of the therapies that you have today, the proteasome inhibitors, the Velcade or Colfrizumib, again, the patients on those therapies have a higher risk of the activation of herpes zoster. So this is why we prophylax and put patients on, antiviral medication when they're on these therapies, so that they don't come down with any of these situations. Here's a picture of the herpes zoster. So just in case this happened here, you can just take a look at this. I mean, the herpes zoster eruptions can be extremely painful. This vesicular rash here, so this is what it would look like. And it doesn't cross what we call the dermatome. It's always unilateral on one side. And generally, in that area, it's usually usually we find that it is to be, you know, in the thoracic area oftentimes. We have to also be careful. It can happen, you know, in the patient's eye. So if you have any unusual rash that looks blistery like that, it's important for you to let your clinical team know. So infection prevention, again, you know, we have, if you have myeloma, you have a compromised immune function, and so it can come from your disease, it can come from treatment. So very important is good clean hand washing. Right now we're getting into the flu season. Patients are very sick with lots of colds and, you know, upper respiratory infections or sinus infections. So again, we can give medications, antibacterials, antivirals. We give growth factor. If we feel that your white count is low, we're going to give you, again, growth factor to build up your white count, so, you know, so we can protect yourself against infection. This is extremely very important, just again preventing any type of infection. And again, I talked about earlier, yeah, immunizations, but no live vaccines. So so we don't, for the herpes zoster, we don't want you to get that live vaccine because you're immune compromised. But again, just to keep in mind, prevention, good clean hand washing, and trying to avoid being around patients that are sick. So the diagnostic criteria for the symptomatic myeloma, patients will have abnormal plasma cells greater than 10%. They'll have abnormal protein in their serum or urine, in one or more of what we call the crab features of organ damage, which would be a hypercalcemia. Again, that's caused, you know, secondary to bone breakdown, renal dysfunction, anemia, or bone disease. So this, I'm going to kind of change gears here and talk about some therapies. You know, multiple myeloma, as we know, is no longer a one-size-fits approach anymore. Obviously, the physicians take many factors into account when deciding on what is the best treatment for every individual patient with myeloma. Dr. Richardson is going to talk about this in more detail, but I just think that the picture is, you know, speaks a thousand words here, is that we have so many therapies since, you know, in the last 16 years for the treatment of multiple myeloma. So all of these new treatments that we have in combination with other therapies obviously translates to real hope for our patients in myeloma. Research is ongoing all the time. We still have a lot of work to do, but Dr. Richardson will go into this in further detail. Also, what's important about the myeloma cell, it's a clonal disease and it changes over time. Effective treatment reduces or eliminates the dominant clone, but others can still exist, and ongoing treatment to suppress these clones is important. And this is why we continue, in our practice, we continue to treat until progression. So a lot of times our patients probably want, you know, a break from their disease. They need, you know, time off from their therapy, but it's in the best patient's interest to continue therapy to suppress the clone of the myeloma clone. So we have lots of therapies, and I'm just going to go over some of these just briefly. Lenalidomide, this was approved back in 2006 along with thalidomide. This is an immunomodulatory class drug. It has many properties that not only go after the microenvironment where the plasma cells grow, but it also has a lot of properties that will help to boost the immune system. And so lenalidomide, and my next slide on pomalidomide, this is why these drugs are used in combination with the new immune therapies that would have been approved, again, synergistically working together to go after the myeloma. So I'm not going into all of these, but, you know, we've worked with these drugs for many, many years. We know all the good properties of these drugs. We know the side effects. But again, as part of your care team, as part of the supportive care, patients on these immunomodulatory drugs such as lenalidomide, thalidomide, or pomalidomide, whether these are given to you in single agent or in combination with dexamethasone or other drugs or the immunotherapies, we know that these can cause patients to have thrombotic events. Again, this is why we make sure that patients are anticoagulated, which I'll talk about in more detail in just a minute. So Dr. Richardson will certainly talk about the exciting news out of ASH in using combination of pomalidomide with the monoclonal antibodies. As we know, many patients are on these drugs, and so just for time's sake, I'm going to let Dr. Richardson address most of these. Bortezomib, this was approved back in 2003, which is the Velcade. It was the first-in-class proteasome inhibitor that was approved. Again, pomalidomide and lenalidomide and Velcade has changed how we treat multiple myeloma, you know, throughout the world. So we have these classes of drugs, the immunomodulatory and the proteasome inhibitors. So again, these are the most exciting times in myeloma. So bortezomib, as many patients in this room, I'm sure, have been on, can cause some thrombocytopenia, nausea, diarrhea, but we know one of the major side effects was peripheral neuropathies, which was actually a toxicity that was really dose-limiting, or patients just could not take that anymore. So some of the side effects for peripheral neuropathies, again, the disease itself can cause peripheral neuropathies, you know, a high burden of the proteins on the nerve endings. Also, if patients have vertebral compression fractions, causing radiculopathy, causing nerve pain, but the drug itself, so sensory, motor or autonomic, the sensory is that tingling and numbness that patients feel. The motor can be the weakness sometimes patients will talk about in their legs. And the autonomic can talk about a patient's heart rate, their blood pressure, you know, patients are having dizziness, or hypotension, etc. But peripheral neuropathy, the risk factors and general considerations, and I feel like this is one of my very most important slides because there are other non-myeloma causes of peripheral neuropathy, and so we need to keep those in mind. They could be endocrine disorders. Patients could have hypothyroidism, so this is something that we need to check. Patients could have diabetes, and we know that diabetes can cause, you know, nerve-ending death, so again, patients can have issues with that. Nutritional disease, patients could have vitamin B deficiency, and oftentimes, I will tell you, in our practice, we do send off a titer for a level of for vitamin B, especially vitamin B12, because as we get older, our vitamin B12 stores are depleted. You know, overuse of alcohol could be connective tissue disorders, medications that we're taking, the herpes zoster that I spoke about. And so, again, these can all cause some of the sensory deficits and pain. So, and then we can look at this and the other side of the slide and look at myeloma disease and treatment related. Obviously, some of the drugs that you've gotten in the past, bortezomib, thalidomide, carfilzomib, or pomalidomide, we have to keep in mind, and we do know the side effects of these drugs can cause patients to have peripheral neuropathies. So this is why when we see you in clinic, we're always, you know, inquiring and asking, you know, about signs and symptoms of peripheral neuropathies, tingling and numbness in your extremities, feeling of coldness, of patients are having pain. And so just through simple methods of appropriate dose modifications or changing your schedule can, you know, alleviate some of these side effects that you may be having from peripheral neuropathy. Bortezomib sub-Q was approved in 2012, and with the sub-Q bortezomib, the risk of peripheral neuropathy was much less with this. And so if you're getting the bortezomib or the Velcade subcutaneously at your center, it's just very important is that you know, that your nurse who is administering the subcutaneous bortezomib, that they inject the drug very slowly. So 10 seconds for every 1 cc. So if you had a syringe that had 2.5 cc's, it should take 25 seconds for that to go in, because we don't want the drug going in fast, because what happens, it will come back out of the skin and lay on the surface of the patient's skin and cause a rash. So, you know, as I always say, it's not a rash. This is a cytotoxic agent, and so just make sure that wherever you're getting your treatment, that they're putting the drug in very slowly. And so now what we have here is Ninlaro. This is the first FDA-approved oral proteasome inhibitor. So this was very exciting. And so where did they come up with the name Ninlaro? So Ninlaro is the last half of the name is oral, spelt backwards. In the 9 here is the Roman numeral IX for the generic name is exazimib. So this is something that you can talk about. I always think it's a neat way they came up with the name. And in studies, we call this MLN-9708. And I know over at Millennium or Takeda, they always refer to the drug as 9. So this is where they came up with Ninlaro. So this is very exciting. This was approved just this year. And this is in combination. It was approved in combination for patients with relapsed refractory myeloma in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. Patients do well on this. Again, with the oral, we do see less of the peripheral neuropathy. You know, it can cause some GI toxicities, and so, you know, again, we can manage those by, you know, giving anti-diarrheals or anti-nausea medications for the patients. This is the schedule. It's given once weekly, so out of a 28-day schedule, so it's given once a week for 3 weeks in a row, which we do day 1, 8, and 15 of a 28-day cycle. Lenalidomide is for 21 days, and the dexamethasone is days 1, 8, 15, and 22. Carfilzomib is a second-generation proteasome inhibitor. The scheduling here is given days 1, 2, 8, 9, 15, and 16. Again, as I said, it's a more sustained type of a proteasome inhibitor. It kind of latches onto the cells for a much longer period of time. And in that context, we do see some cardiovascular issues with this, and I know Dr. Richardson will talk about that in more detail, but just to keep that in mind, that it could be a very serious side effect with the treatment of carfilzomib, and patients can get carfilzomib alone or in combination with lenalidomide or pomalidomide or other drugs, etc. So talking about other therapies that we have, certainly we have the monoclonal antibody therapies in treating patients with, you know, with multiple myeloma. And so what these monoclonal antibodies do is, you know, as we know, they attach themselves to the cancer cells and they make themselves more visible in the immune system. So the immune system attacks those foreign invaders. And this is really, you know, we are on the cusp of a complete shift paradigm in how we are treating our myeloma patients. And, you know, again, I'm so excited to be a part of this with the monoclonal antibodies as I was a part of all the novel agents, you know, back in the year 2000. And again, Dr. Richardson is going to talk in detail about these, but to know that we have more drugs in our armamentarium for treating myeloma is just so exciting. And so, like as I talked about, everything and with therapies, you know, there's always the good part that we can have side effects. And we do see some infusion-related reactions. We can see this with the daratumumab therapy. You know, as your nurses, they are well aware that these, you know, side effects or these infusion-related therapies, the infusion reactions can happen, and this is why you are given many, many of the, antihypertensive medications, so that would kind of make your stay a little bit longer in clinic. Daratumumab can take up sometimes up to 8 hours to infuse. Again, it has to start to go in very slowly, and then as time goes on, we can, you know, after the first cycles, we see the most infusion-related reactions at about 43%. With the first infusion, and as you can see by looking at the slide here, is that after the second and third, the infusion-related reactions go down over time, that your immune system gets tempered by the drug, and so you see less infusion reactions. But we know that they can happen. As you can see, it's as high as 43% in the first infusion of the drug. But, you know, your care team is very, very well aware of these side effects. So some of the most common can be nasal congestion. So if you're getting the infusion and you start to get nasal congestion, you need to ring that bell to talk to your nurse. It can be throat irritation, cough, shortness of breath, chills. Again, we can temper this by giving, you know, stopping the infusion and administering more antihypertensive medications and antihypersensitivity medications, and then going on with your therapy. So these are the management, and just as your care team, they need to act very fast in treating the reaction they're having. So steroids are a very important part of the treating with multiple myeloma, and everybody hates, I can see people nodding their heads. Nobody likes taking the steroids, and I perfectly understand. They're very difficult, but they play a very important role in treating myeloma. They also actually can cause apoptosis to the myeloma cells, and they also help the other drugs to work synergistically together, again, going after different signaling pathways, going after that myeloma cells. But so what I tell some of my patients is that some of the dosing times may help them to relieve that sleeplessness that they have. And so instead of the AM dosing, they can take their steroid at bedtime. And people look at me like that I'm crazy. But you know what happens is that if you take your steroid at bedtime, you're sleeping, you know, you're going to sleep and you're sleeping off those side effects. And they won't, you know, disturb you until maybe you may wake up at 5 in the morning instead of your 6 o'clock, but at least you're getting a good night's sleep. And to try this, I mean, I always tell patients, just don't try it once and say you don't like it. You need to try it, several times to see if you can get into a rhythm with it. Some patients will tell me they'll only take their dexamethasone at bedtime. Other patients say it doesn't work for me, and so they'll continue just taking it during the daytime. Make sure you take it with food. I laugh at this one, mood stabilizers. We know how difficult in the physiological and psychological side effects of steroids. And so we know that the caretaker or the spouse of the person or the partner whose partner's taking the drug is the one that is having the difficulty with it. I always say to the patient, how are you doing with the steroid? And they're like, fine, I'm great, everything's great. And then you ask the spouse and they're like, you know what, I've got to move out of the house. So anyway, so it's very important to, just let your care team know. We can make dose adjustments. It's very important, dose modification, as I always say in any therapy, there's nothing wrong with dose modification, because what's going to happen is that we're trying to tailor the dose to you. Not everybody can take 40 milligrams. Not everybody can take the same dose of lenalidomide or pomalidomide or bortezomib. So it's very important that we tailor the dose to every individual patient. And what happens is that over time, they're going to be getting that exponentially. They're going to be getting that dose over time, so cumulatively. So dose modification, we want to tailor the drug to the dosing to the patient. So this way, they stay on therapy longer, and they're going to get the benefit of that therapy. So very important also to monitor hypoglycemia. This slide, as you can see, can go on and on and on about side effects with steroids, but this is where your care team comes in and helps, the patients with, combating some of the side effects that we see. So we know that they can be difficult, but again, talk to your clinicians about dose modification if need be. So I'm going to start to wrap this up and talk about some venous thrombotic events, signs and symptoms. So the disease of multiple myeloma is hypercoagulable, so you could be at a risk for a thrombotic event, which means a clot, or the therapies that you're taking, the immunomodulatory drugs in combination with dexamethasone can exponentially increase a clotting episode. So a DVT, so these are signs and symptoms of a DVT. If this has happened, a slight fever, rapid heart rate, swelling usually in one or the other leg. Usually it's not bilateral, it's just one or the other or one arm. A PE, which is a pulmonary embolism, obviously a medical emergency. Again, if you're having acute shortness of breath, chest discomfort, this is when you need to call or go to the emergency room or call your clinical team. So how do we manage this? Strategies, anti-embolism stockings. So for patients, again, only worn during the daytime. Exercise is really important. It's important to get up and move around. A low-dose aspirin, again, we do put all our patients who are on immunomodulatory drugs, we do put them on anticoagulation, but deciding what coagulation is up to your doctor, and we risk stratify. If a patient has never had a history of a clot, then we generally would go with a full dose aspirin. If a patient has had a history of a clot, we're going to suggest something like a low molecular weight heparin or Coumadin or something like that, but we would refer our patients to the benign heme team. So just to keep that in mind. If you're traveling, even when I'm on a plane, I'm always moving my feet back and forth, which is important. So health maintenance in patients with myeloma. Your patients are living longer, and they need to consider long-term health behavior. So health maintenance is really important in myeloma. Make sure that you have a primary care physician to prevent, for health screening, getting your flu shot, getting your yearly physical exam. Adopt that healthy lifestyle, making sure you're exercising, you have activity, a good diet. Obviously, we got to think about our proper care for our caregivers. So to thank all of the caregivers that are, that are advocates and supports for their patients, their loved ones that has myeloma, and certainly making sure you communicate with your healthcare team. So in just conclusion, we know, and especially after hearing this morning with all the physicians and Dr. Richardson coming up, many new therapies to treat multiple myeloma are in the pipeline. It's important for your care team and for the patient to know the drugs in the class for better education, surveillance, and continued therapy. Research is needed to inform the sequencing, obviously, of these drugs. So, you know, I've been treating myeloma patients for a very long time, and this is the best time ever for patients and for the physicians, because we can offer such a wide variety of treatments for our patients. And it's you, the patients, that have paved the way for our progress. And if it weren't for the willingness of all of you patients to participate in clinical trials, we would not be as far as we are today in the progress that we have made in multiple myeloma. So with that, I want to say thank you so much for your attention. I've really enjoyed being here today. You know, it's so nice for me to see a lot of my patients. So thank you so much.
Kathy, thank you very, very much. And that was tremendously important because a lot of things were covered that are critical for symptom management and a more general view of myeloma as well. Brendan, Christian, I think we've got two questions, correct?
So the first one, for smoldering patients, should they also follow the rule of not having IV contrast dyes or also not using ibuprofen or following those?
Great question, and absolutely, yes, they should not. They should avoid it at all costs. IV contrast doesn't just apply to CTs. When you're also getting MRI imaging as well, that becomes important to bear in mind when you're using gadolinium, and there are a variety of strategies to moderate that. So it's a great question. Thank you for asking.
And the second was, can kyphoblasty be used on spinal fractions that have already healed?
Kathy. Spinal fractures that have already healed.
No, they won't do that. It's generally for an acute vertebral compression fracture. They really like it to be like within like 6 weeks. I mean, there are, but if they do an MRI and they see a hot spot and they see edema around the area, then that person could be a candidate for it. But the interventional radiologist will make that determination.
Yeah. And ideally, it's before radiation therapy, isn't
yeah.
it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, good.
There's actually one more question I was asked earlier. It was about calcium supplements. When is that appropriate or good for a patient to be taking?
That's a great question. And also, please, everyone remember, we'll be going over everything afterwards as well. But the calcium and vitamin D supplementation, definitely once you've started bisphosphonates, become important. Prior to that, it very much depends, because recognizing hypercalcemia is a feature of our illness. So in that context, it would very much depend on what the calcium is doing. If the calcium is normal, then and you're about to start bisphosphonates, it's appropriate. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if you've got hypercalcemic weight, get that under control and then go forward. Good. Excellent.
Okay, sorry.
Kathy.
I'm sorry if I went over.
No,
sorry.
Not at all. Kathy,
thank you.
It's very valuable. Thank you very much. Thank you, Kathy.
Wonderful.